So welcome back to Forgiving Challenge, a 40-day journey leading to your freedom. And we've come a long way, and we have just one last step. Today we're at historic Trinity Parish in St. Augustine, Florida. This church boasts the oldest church building in all of Florida. It's 200 years old. And even before the building, the church was formed, and before it was known as Trinity, it was known as St. Peter's, which is interesting to us because we've been looking at the story of the disciple Peter. So before I invite you into the fifth and final step, what I want to do today is review where we've been. We've been using the acronym SCARS, and we started with this first S talking about how the reason we're not free is because we sin. Every one of us misses the mark. But after we sin, God invites us to a practice called confession, where we bring all of our sorrow, all of our guilt, all of our shame to Him, and He promises to forgive us. The last 2 weeks, we've looked at His forgiveness with the word absolution. We talked about how that was God's declaration of forgiveness over your lives, that your sin, my sin, Peter's sin, everyone's sin has been paid for ultimately by the death of Jesus on the cross, paid in full. But then we talked about His forgiveness. There's a second aspect where not only did He cancel the debt, but He's not angry or resentful towards you. He loves you, and He works to fully restore you back not only to being His child, but to live a life of meaning and purpose. And it's this fifth and final phase today called sanctification that makes all the difference on whether you truly live a free life or not. The definition of sanctification is to be free from sin, or to live a holy and set apart life. And this is really the key to freedom, is when you, who don't just understand and know that God's forgiveness is for you and know that He wants to restore you, but truly walk into the life and step into the life God invited you into, that's when you're going to experience freedom. This is also the saddest part of the journey because I think people are so close and so many leave the journey at this part. Why is that? It's because in things like absolution and restoration, like those are things only God can do. We're not involved in that. That's God's beautiful work done to us and through and for us. But sanctification is a process that we cooperate with God and His Holy Spirit inside of us to live a holy and set apart life, which means you are part of the process, which means it's a vulnerable place to be because the enemy's going to attack and try to tell you things about your old life and why you can't follow Jesus and bring fear and all these boundaries in and burdens in the way of you pursuing Jesus. But today I want to invite you to step up into that life, no matter what fear the enemy may bring or what boundaries he may put in your life. Let's step up together and live those holy set apart lives that God has won for us. But first, let's see what our man Peter, what happened in his story. So Peter has received the forgiveness of Jesus, been fully restored, and invited into a life of purpose and meaning to follow after Jesus and to be the pastor of the first church. So what would Peter do? Would he step up into this life and take it upon himself? Thankfully, we don't have to guess because it's recorded for us. And I just love some of the ways the Bible works because John 21, that 89th chapter, if you just flip one page, the very next book is Acts. And Peter is like the central figure, of course, God working through him in the first 12 chapters of Acts. And we're going to see his leadership skills on display very early on. In fact, in Acts chapter 2, the 12 disciples are in a room. Now, this time they're not quarantining out of fear, but they're worshiping together and they're there to celebrate Pentecost in Jerusalem. And at Pentecost Sunday, all of a sudden, the Holy Spirit descends upon the disciples, and God-fearing Jews from every nation, tribe, and language are there as well. And there's this incredible confusion going on because now the disciples are speaking languages they didn't even know they knew of the other people, and it's amazing. And some were not sure what was going on in all of this. And in the middle of all this chaos and confusion, here's this awesome verse from Acts chapter 2, verse 14. Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice, and addressed the crowd. And in the next 30-some verses, Peter delivers this magnificent sermon, telling everyone in the crowd that day who Jesus was and what Jesus did and what his life, death, and resurrection means. And at the end of this sermon, so many people, the Bible says, were cut to the heart and wondering what to do next. And after that, they went into the waters of baptism, and the Bible tells us that that day, more than 3,000 people were added to their number. The church, which was 120 strong at the beginning, is now 3,120 strong. What I love about this story, though, is Peter, the same thing that got him into trouble was the same thing that God used in an incredible way. The mouth that denied Jesus in front of one servant girl is now standing boldly and professing who Jesus is in front of thousands. And this wasn't like a slow, gradual bleed, and over time he's improving a little bit. Think about this. This was only 50 days after the resurrection, 52 days after he denied in front of a servant girl, he's now using his mouth to profess Jesus. This is what the freed life looks like, when we can take even our sins of the past and the things that were broken in the past and use them for God in the future. Here at Trinity Parish, they are known for one of the world's greatest stained glass window collections. But the one we're looking at here is of utmost importance to our story. This was Jesus, the very first time, calling Peter to follow me. And Peter has had quite a journey, even in our story, but his journey would continue. And what I think you're going to see is that the charcoal fire incident in the 89th chapter really did change Peter forever and ever. And he really did live a life following after Christ. So we talked about this world-changing message in Acts chapter 2, but Peter would go on to be the first pastor of this church and lead this church to incredible heights. In fact, the church, only 120 strong in chapter 1, by chapter 21 is now tens of thousands of people. Not only this, but modern day churches today still strive for the healthy marks that the early church is known for. Things like attention to word and prayer and community service and generosity. Even Peter himself would be known for being bold and courageous and speaking in public about Jesus, even if it got him in trouble, even if it got him thrown in prison, which, by the way, freedom in Christ doesn't always equal freedom in this world. At the time of Peter doing this, of course, there was the Roman Emperor Nero that hated Christians and really persecuted Christians because they represented a threat to his government and to even himself. And so he was going after all of them, and of course, chief among them was Peter. And so not only did he catch Peter, but he actually crucified Peter for his faith. Except there's this interesting story tradition tells us that as Peter was going to be crucified and die in the same manner in which Jesus did, he said, "I don't deem myself worthy to die in the same manner as Jesus, so crucify me upside down." And they hung Peter upside down, and there Peter was, dead, because he believed and followed Jesus all the way to the end. And while you may think this is a sad ending, I think it's what Peter always wanted. Remember the night of the Last Supper where Peter said, "Jesus, I'll never deny you. Even if everyone else does, I'll be faithful all the way till the end." And the one who failed in front of one servant girl is now hanging upside down dead, following Jesus faithfully all the way to the end. It's what Peter always wanted. And the grace and forgiveness of Jesus changed this man all the way until that moment. So how do you see Peter? Do you see him for his big blunders, or like Jesus, do you now know him and see him as the big boulder and rock that he became? Truthfully, I don't know that Peter cares that much what you think about him, but I know he cares about what you think about Jesus. There's four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and nearly all scholars agree that the Gospel of Mark was the one that was actually the first one written, and that Matthew, Luke, and John would all borrow as they're writing their Gospels from Mark. Here's what's interesting, though. Mark was not an eyewitness of the account and the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus, and so someone had to tell Mark what to write. And here's where it gets interesting. Church fathers like Eusebius and Irenaeus and Origen and Papias all unanimously agree that the one that told Mark about the stories of Jesus was none other than Peter himself, which means that not only the Gospel of Mark, but really in all four Gospels, we see Peter's retelling of the story of Jesus all throughout these. And not only do we see Peter's retelling of the story of Jesus, but we have Peter telling his own stories of his own weaknesses and of his own blunders. What kind of a man has become so content that he is willing to see, for you to see him at his worst? Only a man that's become free. Only a man that's become forgiven. Peter is willing for you to see him at his worst in order that you would see Jesus at his best. And that's my prayer for you in this series, that you would have seen Jesus at his best. That the same things he's done for Peter, he's done for you, and he'll keep doing for you. That you would see that Jesus loves you, Jesus forgives you, Jesus restores you, and Jesus also invites you now to follow after him and live a life of meaning and purpose. The Bible says, who the Son has set free is free indeed, and Jesus has set you free. So go now and be free. The Bible says who Jesus has set free is free indeed. And yet so many Christians don't experience that freedom or feel that freedom. Why is that? We're going to go on a 40-day journey called Forgiving Challenge that's going to lead to your freedom. I believe the single biggest key to you being free is knowing that God has forgiven you. We're going to see that nobody forgives like Jesus. And no matter what your past has been, Jesus has an incredible future for you. And so journey together with me these next 40 days, and let's experience God's forgiveness together.